Wow, they really put a lot of esters into that OJ.
Esters? What are those?
They're the chemical compound that produces flavor.
But aren't they the compound that we contribute to smell?
Yeah, you've been paying attention in Chem 264, Organic Chemistry 2 for Chemical Engineers, haven't you, Emma?
I have.
The flavor of a food is a combination of its smell, taste, texture, and appearance.
So if esters determine smell, then what determines taste?
Hi, it's us, Eleanor,
Michaela,
Emma,
Dylan,
but from the future. In the future, we are wise and brilliant, and we are here to teach ourselves how taste works.
Taste is separated into five different categories: sweet, bitter, sour, salty, and umami. Each of these tastes is differentiated by the way it produces sensory signals in the body. In general, the brain perceives taste via the papillae, or taste buds on the tongue. The food in question will bind to different regions of the tongue and to different receptors. Each of the five tastes has its own evolutionary purpose. Sweet indicates that food is rich in nutrients. Umami indicates amino acids. Salty allows for an electrolytic balance. Sour indicates acidity. And bitter allows for a sense of diverse natural toxins.
Now we're going to go to Eleanor from the future to talk about the mechanism for sweet taste.
Okay. It's a common misconception that the five tastes bind to different regions of the tongue. There are actually taste receptors all over the tongue that bind to different functional groups, yielding a different taste. Sweetness would technically be found in the same region of the tongue as the bitter and umami flavors. However, it binds to different receptors, specifically the taste receptors T1R2 and T1R3. These receptors are actually very large proteins that are large and complicated. As such, when a sweet food encounters these receptors, it hydrogen bonds with them to send a signal to the brain that, I just ate something sweet. In order to do this, it has some general characteristics of a sweet food. That being that has one, if not multiple, alcohol groups and carbonyl groups. Examples of some sweet compounds would include sugars, artificial sweeteners, and some amino acids. For example, sucrose, which is a sugar and technically a disaccharide because it includes both glucose and fructose, can be seen here, and it has multiple alcohol groups as well as multiple carbonyl groups, thus yielding its sweet taste. Aspartame, which is an artificial sweetener, also has an alcohol group and multiple carbonyl groups. Yes.
Yeah, so my dad doesn't let me drink Diet Coke because it has aspartame in it. Aspartame. He says because it causes cancer. Is that true? Do you know?
No, it is actually not true. That came from some research back in the 1980s from some Italian researchers who found that in rats, the rats developed some blood cancers, but some more recent studies have proved that that research was not true. And our last example is glycine, which is an amino acid. And even though it has a carboxylic acid group, which you will soon learn yields the sour taste, because of that alcohol group and carbonyl group, yields a mild, sweet taste. And with that, I send it off to the bitter flavor.
All right. Bitter taste, much like the sugar taste, has its own receptors for detecting it. And these have evolved mostly to detect potentially poisonous compounds in food, but are now mostly used in detecting chocolate and tea and these compounds that we have up here. When these compounds are consumed, they latch onto a receptor in your taste buds called T2R. And not much is known about this mechanism, but we do know that it latches onto T2R and changes the actual shape of the protein. This triggers other proteins that start the potential action potential mechanism that eventually leads to a signal in your brain that tells you that it is bitter. So we have these two compounds out here. Theobromine is found mostly in chocolate, and caffeine is found not only in chocolate, but also coffee. You have a question?
Yeah, so this molecule, theobromine, doesn't have any bromine
in it, so why is it called theobromine?
That's a great question. So the actual atom bromine comes from the Greek word bromos, which means stinky or smelly, which they detected, obviously, when they were just looking at bromine or smelling bromine. However, the bromine part in this word comes from the Greek word broma, which means food, and the word theo comes from the Greek word for god. So when you take these together, it means the food of the gods, which kind of reflects the Aztec culture of the chocolate being a very ritual food and very important to their culture, which is a little piece of history for you. Quinine actually uses a different pathway. Quinine blocks its tasks in the human body, which are presented in the taste buds. This causes the action potential to happen earlier than it should, and so when this happens, it actually signals the bitter taste without the actual rest of the mechanism being required. Another notable bitter chemical is denatonium, which is shown right here. Denatonium is the most bitter compound known to man, and it's so bitter that it's actually unbearable to most people in solutions of greater than 10 parts per million. This quality is important because it is mostly used for preventing people from consuming the things that they should not. It's put in denatured ethanol, which is used in labs to prevent people from drinking it. It's also used in antifreeze and windshield wiper fluid, because those are normally sweet things and prevents people or animals from consuming them when they shouldn't. It is also used in placebos for medication to reflect the bitter taste of most medicines. And is also a solution of detonium benzoate is used on Nintendo Switch cards, which are small and it prevents them from being consumed by small children. So that's all I have for the bitter taste, and now we're going to be moving on to sour and salty.
The way that we taste sour foods is much different than the way that we taste sweet or bitter ones. The compound that creates the signals of a sour taste is very simple. It's a hydrogen ion. The presence of hydrogen ions in taste bud cell membranes activates certain channels while deactivating others. These changes in the cell membrane signal the brain to a sour taste in the food. But where do these hydrogen ions come from? The majority of sour foods contain organic acids. These organic acids deprotonate in contact with saliva, which acts as a water-like solution. Yes, you have a question?
So how do we know that these acids deprotonate in water?
Yeah, that's a great question. So we can convince ourselves that these acids deprotonate in water, because if we look at an example, such as tartaric acid, you'll see this group at the end here, and it's going to look pretty familiar. That's because this group is characteristic of a carboxylic acid. And as we all know, carboxylic acids are acids, which means that this hydrogen will deprotonate in solution. These are some examples of organic acids that are found in common foods. Tartaric acid and citric acid are the compounds responsible for the sour taste of Sour Patch Kids. Lactic acid is responsible for the taste of pickles, and benzoic acid is found in cranberries. These organic acids are also the reason that after consuming a large amount of sour candy or sour fruit, one's tongue will be sore for a day or two. Similar to how the influx of hydrogen ions causes the brain to experience sour, an influx of sodium ions signals the brain to a salty taste. These sodium ions pass through sodium channels in taste bud cell membranes, which then sends the signal to the brain. When a person is sodium deficient, their body produces a hormone called aldosterone, which increases the number of sodium channels found on the membrane, and thus increases the ability to taste salt. There's also a compound called amylaride, which decreases the amount of salt that you taste by muting this flavor. Now, we'll go to talk about the most recent flavor.
Umami, the savory taste, is the hardest to understand and describe. It used to be thought of as a combination of other tastes. However, it has its own receptors. Umami is the meaty flavor found in, of course, meats and Parmesan cheese. It was discovered in 1906 by Japanese professor Kikune Akita. He isolated monosodium glutamate, or MSG, as the molecule responsible for the umami taste. He also proposed a research theory that there are umami receptors in the stomach and that it helps with digestion. The mechanism for tasting umami is very similar to that of sweet and bitter tastes. MSG binds the receptors on the tongue and signals your brain that you are eating a savory food. MSG is naturally found in meat, poultry, eggs, tomatoes, and dairy products, such as cheese. It is widely used as a flavor enhancer and found in millions of consumer products. Most unprocessed foods are MSG-free, whereas almost every processed food does contain MSG or the very similar molecule disodium glutamate. Question.
Isn't MSG bad for you, though?
Not necessarily. Because MSG is found naturally in many foods. There are anecdotal reports that MSG causes headaches and other allergic reactions. Although there isn't any scientific evidence of an allergy, there are individuals who are more sensitive to MSG and tend to avoid it in their daily lives.
We can convince ourselves that taste is not as complicated as you might think.
Thanks to this video, if your friends ever ask you about how taste works at the lunch table, you can show off your cool chemistry knowledge.
Yeah, I'm gonna take my horse to the old town road. I'm gonna ride till I can't no more. I'm gonna take my horse to the old town road. I'm gonna ride till I can't no more.